Jesus, the true vine. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing.
Good morning again. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, pour your Holy Spirit in upon us today, so may we understand your word and apply it to our lives. In your name we pray. Amen. You know, Dr. James Dobson, Christian psychologist and founder of Focus on Family, says this: today, people have a negative sense of using the term authority. They feel it represents oppressing power, dictatorship, or standing on one side, not listening or embracing the other side. People forget the term authority comes from Latin word auctoritas, meaning advice, protection, guide, and lead. You know, Bible is the authority, the only authority, the only book that God wrote. It contains 66 books, 39 books in the Old Testament, and 27 in the New Testament. Both are the revelations of God before Christ and coming of Christ. Together makes up the 66 books of the Bible. And in the Bible, God speaks. When you come together, we don't come together to listen men speak, but we come to hear God speak. So the responsibility of the pastor, the preacher, and the Bible teacher is to take the message from God and bring it to the people. And so I've always seen myself not as a chef, but as a waiter. And my responsibility is not to create the meal, but bring it to the table without messing it up, without messing up the truth. And we all do whenever we open up the scripture and study the word of God. The truth is, when you come to John 15, Jesus is the vine and we are the branches. If you are not the true vine, then we will be cut off. If you are not attached to Christ, then we are not the true branches, then we are not saved. It's very simple. John 15, today's passage, is very simple. It's about a salvation. If you allow me to compare it to food, it is as simple as milk and cereal. Anyone can make it, and anyone can eat it. But the problem is, we face today, people make this simple truth very complicated. It's like they say, no, Jesus says 2% milk. No, silk milk or fat-free milk. No, Jesus says 10% fiber, 20% calcium, and no sugar. No. Jesus said 10% sugar, and the sugar should be made out of sugar beet, not the sugar cane. So we're talking about sugar now. There's no milk. There's no cereal. So we ended up talking about sugar. You know, Jaden last year didn't do really well on his English test. So my wife came up to me and said, honey, we need to, you know, educate, we need to schedule our kids' study time. When they come from their school, they have to finish their homework, then read all the you know, assignment reading, then take a break and eat, then study again, then go to bed. I said, honey, that's too much, okay? So let them, you know, just take a break, you know, watch TV, then eat, then study. Then she said, no, they need to study first, take a break and eat. I said, no, they need to take a break. Then she all of a sudden brought up, why all Korean men don't support their wife? So it's all about Korean men now. Korean cultural system, educational system, and my personality, my family personality. So he ended up, I'm a bad guy. No kids education, I'm a bad guy. You know, last summer, I was driving through Utah and saw a huge billboard sign standing next to a rest area on the freeway. And it says, when you die today, heaven or hell? Simple message. We all understand. Then I overheard the people saying, wow, that must be Baptist. That must be a Methodist. No, that must be Job. The sign is big, or the sign is too small. They don't get to the point, but they're talking about something else. So based upon today's passage, people are talking about something else. It is about God's salvation. If you are not the true branches, you go to hell. If you are true branches, you go to heaven. Simple message. Hell or heaven? Very simple message. But some biblical scholars say that the vine represents Israel as the chosen people, each individual chosen people. But some people say, no, the vine represents the symbol of Israel as a nation, a whole nation. It's not each individual people. The term cut off doesn't necessarily mean completely cut off. It's not necessarily mean hell or heaven. It means lift it up, fix you. You still have a chance. They're talking about something else. So there's no salvation. So Jesus has to say the truth, the point of the chapter 15 at the end of his 3-year discipleship training. He's talking about the nature of genuine salvation. It's very simple. I repeat again. You go to heaven if you are in Christ. If you are not, you go to hell. Period. That's it. You know, Jesus is about to enter Jerusalem and he was about to confront the religious leaders and be persecuted and die. So Jesus knew there were not many time to teach his disciples. So he comes with this very essence of his teaching at the end of his 3-year discipleship. You know, this is called Passion Week. Jesus enters into Jerusalem, we call Passion Week. Passion comes from Latin word suffering. So we call it Suffering Week. Jesus knew the suffering time was coming. He knew he didn't have much time. So he had to say this. This is the last moment he can wrap up the 3-year training course for his disciples and deliver the main point of his teaching. I am the true vine. I am the single person. I am. Not we are, not they are. And this very simple sentence is very familiar to his disciples. You know, throughout the scripture, God reveals himself My name is I am that I am. I am the bread. I am the living bread that comes from heaven. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the shepherd. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection. I am the truth and the way and the life. I am, I am. God keeps saying, I am, I am. But people still don't understand. Jesus is the truth. You know the real funny thing? The real funny thing about this I am theology? People didn't pay attention to this I am theology before the movie Star Wars. Star Wars 2, which was came out in 1980, you know, Star Wars 2nd, the Empire Strikes, I forgot, Empire Strikes the, what's the, Empire Strikes Back, I'm sorry, Empire Strikes Back, and the Darth Vader says, I am your father. Then everybody, who? My father told me, I didn't watch the movie, mother, I was very young, my father told me he went to movie theater, watching the movie, then Darth Vader said, I am the father. The entire audience, because I am the father. Then all the churches and theologians and pastors, they, you know, they used the quote, I am the father. So God is the father. So 1980, people began to pay attention to the I am theology. It's very funny. Before that, not many pastors pay attention to I am theology. I am the vine. Jesus had to say this at this moment because there was one person who didn't understand who Jesus is. Judas Iscariot, who has a high profile, who carried all the money. He had been following Christ for 3 years, so close that people didn't even know he had no life. You know, there was nothing manifestly obvious in the life, character, and behavior of Judah that would have distinguished him as a first disciple. He was visibly attached, and for all intention and purposes, looked like everyone else did what everyone else did. He's like one of us. Nobody couldn't see that. He had no life. But Jesus said, Judah didn't really belong to the Lord. In John 13, after Christ ate with his disciples and washed their feet, Judas walked away from the Lord permanently. Finally, he was gone. After 3 years, he was gone. He is what the Bible would call him, apostate, an ultimate defector. So Jesus had to say, there is a someone here, he's going to be cut off. Now John 21, 30, chapter, verse 31, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into my kingdom. Revelation chapter 3, verse 1, you have a name, reputation, being alive, but you are dead. Name, reputation, but you are dead. You know, I think about this all the time. We have name and reputation. I'm a pastor, deacons, elders, Bible school teacher, or a church leader. I go to church all the time. People see me as a very faithful and a truthful follower of Christ. I'm a hard worker all the time for the church. We all have reputation. The moment you took the position at the church, people assume that you are the leader and you are a godly person. So people see we are all godly person. Because we have the title, we have the name, reputation. You know, I walk to church most of the time, and on the way, I often saw a man sitting right in front of his house and smoking, and his dog, maybe two dogs, were jumping around all the time. We just say hi, you know, to each other. I don't know him, he doesn't know me. Then one day I had a chance to talk to him, sitting in front of his house, still smoking. Then he asked me, "Hey, where are you going?" I said, "I'm going to the church down there." Then he asked me, "What are you doing there?" I said, "I am the new pastor at the church." Then he, you know, put out the smog and Charlie got off his seat, you know. "Oh, I thought you were the new Chinese cook at the restaurant." You know, I have a title, pastor. So he assumed that somehow I'm a godly person. So we're hiding something. To be honest, as a pastor, I can easily hide or disguise myself as a godly person. You never know. But Jesus says, you have a name, reputation, being alive, but you are dead. You are dead. So our Lord comes along and says, if you want to be connected to God, you have to connect it not to the title, not to your name, not to your ancestors, not to your reputation, but to me. I am the true vine, Elithinos, the true vine. I am the perfect vine. Through me, the life of God flows. He is the true vine. You know, last week, I don't know if you saw this, this one on your TV, Google company engineer department called DeepMind, okay? DeepMind developed computer artificial intelligence called AlphaGo. And it's a computer program that had its own intuition and, you know, feelings and learn from its mistake and study. So AlphaGo, so one day academic ability is equal to 35 years of human ability. It's like a human brain. The computer learns itself and study by itself. And last week, the computer artificial intelligence played a Chinese board game and beat the world champion. Hundreds of thousands of people watched the game live on TV and YouTube. Have you guys watched it? There are two games more to go. You can watch it tonight. You might think that, what's a big deal, Jay? What's a big deal? It's a computer game. Of course, computer can win. No, it's not. It's like a computer football coach. Understand each individual's, you know, daily condition, strength and weakness, and make all the offense and defense strategy and try to win the game. It's not a simple computer program. It's like a human brain. The Google company is so excited. World first human intelligent computer program. But the one engineer says that if the computer program understands the spiritual capacity about God, then this machine can be human. You know, that's not going to happen. Okay? That's not going to happen. No matter how intelligent, genius, effective machine is, the spiritual capacity only God can access, only God can give us. That's the realm of God. Human cannot touch it. If you can think that you can touch it, you are not in Christ. You are apostate, permanent defector. So Jesus says, I am the vine. I am the true vine. I am the truth. So our Heavenly Father comes along in our lives with the knife, the painful, sharp knife. He cuts He cuts our sin. He cuts useless, wasteful behavior, preoccupation with the things that don't matter. But we don't know who is going to be cut and who is going to remain. We never know. So Jesus says, remain in me, being attached to Christ. That's why he wants to prune you, discipline you, teach you, tell you, stay with me, stay within me. He gives you this message through scripture, sermon, Bible study, your friend, family, church members, or even your kids. How does he do that? He might do it through sickness. He might do it through hardship. He might do it through the loss of a job, or loss of a friend, loss of a loved one, loss of a material one. He might do it through the loss of reputation, slander. He might do it through a failure, something you worked really hard to pull off. He might do it through persecution from people outside, from people you love. He might do it through grief or disappointment. He might be extremely emotionally painful. He might be extremely physical painful. This is God providentially using the knife. You could say, why me then? Why? God, why me? Because God intends for you to bear much fruit. So you that will bear more fruit. The more you know the word of God, the more you love the Christ, the better you react to trials. And the more you allow the knife, God's knife, to do its work, you bear much fruit because you have suffered and let God's word do its work. You know, that's the kingdom. That's the kingdom principle. God wants you to be fruit-bearing branches. If you don't know this, you are in a very dangerous situation. You might not be the person who is a saint. Take warning from this passage. Come truthfully to Christ. Remain within Him. Remain to Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are again this morning so blessed together, so thankful. We ask now that you would confirm to our hearts the truth and set it loose in every life to accomplish your purpose. We pray